Hello, everyone. Thank you for tuning in and welcome to the Play Myself Show. My name is Miles and I have Eric and Jason here. And today we will try to publish a show.
You mean we're finally going to put one out?
We're going to try. And we will. Nah, we will. Fuck it. Put out. Yeah. Let's talk about a time you had to put out.
Now, there it is. In less than 1 minute, folks, we made it back to sex.
So we're going to talk about a serious topic today, because today is one day. I'm going to let go ahead, Jason.
Why do I want to put this on the recording? Can we pause real quick?
Yeah. And welcome, everyone, to the Play Myself Show. I'm your host, Miles. I have Eric C. and Jace. I'm just going to take it from the top.
Eric C. all the time.
All right, Eric C. Okay. All right.
Yeah, Jason, Jace, follow me. I don't give a shit. Call me whatever you want.
We're going to talk about voting, but if I don't get this shit done, like, you just fucking have to hear about it.
Based on how the voting goes, you know, it could be anarchy in the streets by the time we put this thing out.
And that's what motivated Eric to be like, just what you got to put this out, because if we don't put it out...
We'll put it out. It's going out.
It'll go out.
We're doing it.
All right. Voting. Did you vote, Jason?
No, I've not voted yet.
Are you going to vote?
I honestly don't know. I haven't voted yet. I mean, I've never voted.
You've never voted?
I've never voted.
Okay, if I'm being honest, I voted for the first time last time.
Ooh. I went last time to vote. No, I went to town before last to vote.
And you realized you hadn't been registered and you weren't.
I showed up. I'm like, I'm here to vote. And they're like, you can't vote. And they sent me away. Wow. I was like, okay.
You really can't vote because you weren't registered to vote?
They won't let me.
How long have you owned a home?
My current home, 4 years.
But you owned homes before that?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's like number one, like, home buying tip 101. Like,
the best part is whoever becomes president is your boss. You should know about voting.
You know, but it does get me. And we mentioned this before. You got 20 years in the service, right? What's that?
You got 20 years in the service.
21 in March.
Okay.
That's hilarious.
I just registered right before the last election. Because I missed the one before. I missed the deadline to register, so I registered. And I finally got to vote for the first time ever in the last election.
Right? You got some nerve calling me out.
But at least I knew not to show up at the polling station unregistered. Hi, I'd like to vote. Where do I go? Sir, have you registered? Yeah, I'd like to register right now.
No, I didn't say that. I said, what are you talking about?
So I'm not registered now, so I still can't vote.
Are you really not registered?
You didn't
know.
Wow. What?
So, I'll shoot Jason some bail. So, is him not voting like me voting for Kanye?
Ooh. No, because Kanye is technically a candidate.
Right.
So, for the last election, I've always assumed that, in my honest opinion, one person in office can't make or break anything, because we have the three, you know, the levels of government. Judicial, whatever the president one's called. And then the House and Senate, right? So I always thought, hey, no way one person can do anything that would embarrass the country, ruin the country, make the country great, whatever. So I simply voted for Trump last time based on SNL was so hilarious at the time with Alec Baldwin. I didn't want that to end in comedy. Being a big comedy fan, was going off the rails with Trump.
I'm starting to feel a little bit better now about my comment.
I voted for Trump solely based. I was like, this could be comedy gold for the next 4 years. And was I wrong? No.
I definitely didn't vote for Trump that first time. But and Trump almost had my vote this time.
And let me ask, did your vote count? Because the popular vote wasn't Trump. More people chose not to vote for Trump, but who was your president?
Not my president.
Who was your president?
Our president.
By a million votes. Wait, Trump lost.
Okay, so you're not voting for Trump this time. You're voting for Kanye.
I vote for Kanye. I vote for Kanye, and my second choice was Jorgensen, because she's a libertarian, and I like,
you know. Oh, yeah, she's an independent on the ballot, right?
No, she's a libertarian on the ballot.
Oh, libertarian on the ballot.
So, I vote libertarian all the time because I like the ideals, and I'm a big fan of, like, freedom. Yeah. And, like, I see, like, to me, like, Trump is doing what we would consider, like, very liberal now, right? Like, so, like, he's giving welfare and promising you know, all these gifts that who's going to pay for it?
Yeah.
So he's, and then, but the Republicans that are in the House, they're just not saying things because they're scared of him because they want him to, you know, do Trump them. So he's not like the ideal Republican president.
No,
like,
they said before he would have ran as a Democrat.
Right.
He used to put money in the Clintons' pockets. Like he was a donor for them. Like
right.
He literally only went to the Republican side because they allowed him into the race.
Yeah.
And nobody thought, I don't even think he thought he was going to win.
And what has me skeptical about the Democratic side is like, why would you have to pick Joe Biden?
Like they were trying to lose.
Dude, this dude is like 79 years old. You trying to tell me there's nobody on that side that y'all could have picked as a better candidate except this old ass dude?
I had this conversation with somebody earlier today. I literally said, if you would have picked Hillary again and put him up like a rematch, like they do in boxing and every other sporting,
right?
I think she would have won. I think I was like when the Democrats picked Biden, I was like, you guys are definitely trying to lose, right? This is on purpose. This has to be on purpose.
That was weird to me. All right, let's go to the next topic. Unless anybody wants to continue to talk about voting.
Or, yeah, what about, how about just voting in general? I mean, aside from the left or the right, just getting out there, like, the mail-in voting, the pre-voting, how the fact that they said the more people have come out and already voted than they did in the entire election last year or something like, or not last year, but last election.
Yeah. So I'd like to go back on something real quick.
Okay.
So when you buy a house, right? You should always register to vote.
Can I do it online? I'm going to do it right now.
No, it's too late, dude.
It's too late.
Can I do it for the next one?
There's going to be another one, right?
Yeah. But because, like, you know, like, say if you need, like, a trim removed or something, like, they can, that's public knowledge that they see, like, that you voted. Like, especially, like, it's more important to vote for local shit than it is for president.
I absolutely believe that.
Right. So, like, if I need something done here, they'll be like, all right, what is he registered? If they see, like, if I'm registered, like, what most people in all my blocks are registered, like, you get more shit.
Really?
Hell yeah.
I never felt that way.
Your wife is probably registered.
She is?
Yeah.
So they'll come to the door, and they start, like, asking for, they'll ask for my, you know, ask for my wife, and they'll say, hi, is your wife here? And I'm like, oh, what is this about? Well, we're asking, they start asking, like, well, we're here to talk to her about the Democratic Party. I'm like, oh, and I'm like, okay, well, she's not here. Oh, what's your name, sir? And I'm like, I'll say my name. Like, yeah, you're not registered. And just walk away.
Yeah.
They look at me like, yep, no thanks. Keep on walking. They're like, oh, that was easy.
If she was a Republican, they probably would think you were illegal.
You know what? That's what I'm dreading the most about the voting, though, is the lines tomorrow. I literally called my dad. This is a true story. Because me and my dad go to the same place because I still use my parents' address for everything. 37 years old, grown-ass man, still using my parents' address. And
that's crazy.
And I go, hey, Dad, just really quick, do you know we're going to have lines tomorrow, blah, blah, with everything, or whatever. He goes, and then I also asked him for a ride. He goes, well, that depends on who you're voting for.
Wow.
Man, that's messed up. But I'm dreading the lines, or even, I don't know, as crazy as everything is right now, is there going to be people protesting? Craig Apple was on, Albany County Sheriff was on the news today saying they're beefing up police security at these polling stations because they're anticipating craziness.
I think after like tomorrow night is gonna be the craziest. Yeah, but like that's people are stupid, man. Like, my buddies always send me like these like Trump supporters and these like stockades or whatever, like chasing like BLM people and shit like that. I'm like, yo, that shit is like, I honestly believe that's China. When you look at your feed, they're showing you shit that is gonna piss you off on purpose.
Oh yeah. Well, you saw that they just had the big three CEOs of Google, Twitter, and Facebook in a Senate hearing.
Right. I mean, I don't know how much that helps, but they'll like it's not, and it's not their fault. But it's like the bots do. Like, I think I heard like last year, Facebook got rid of 3 billion bots.
Oh my God. 3 billion?
3 billion just bots that was just like going into people's feed and doing shit. And as Jason is trying to register to vote on,
I am
on November 2nd, 2020.
I'm trying to register. I'll sell you my vote right now, Jay. My vote is up. Is that legal? I don't even know if that's legal.
Yeah,
I don't care. You got to catch me in the act. That's the way it works, right?
Catch me as you can.
Cash at me.
So that's crazy. So like these guys in these other countries, they literally have farms. So like they're just feeding into
I've heard of those.
Yeah. So they're just feeding hate into your deal. Like I think that like, oh, if I go to California or Texas, like I'm going to be caught up in the drive-by. So like, I just think it was like that bad. But now I realize like that that's, I was being naive. So it's just like when people live on their phone and they don't go outside.
Yeah.
They think all white people hate black people or, I never was like a Black Lives Matter supporter ever. Yeah. I knew that shit was a scam from the beginning.
By the way, think about that. Somebody was talking about this online recently about the Black Lives Matter group. So obviously it came out of a good, you know, thing in a good movement, you know, with police brutality and all that type of stuff. But the people that actually found it, the two women, right? If you actually look at what their views actually are and what they actually had posted on the website.
The nuclear family.
It was crazy.
That's what I'm saying.
And people don't realize that they're just wearing the, because it's a great slogan.
It's a great slogan and it was on top of something.
You can't fight it.
You can't fight that slogan. That's marketing.
They tried to say all lives matter. They fought it.
Yeah. What I love the best though is you see more and more in Crowder was actually talking about this on his YouTube channel recently, but he was talking about you see more white liberal moms wearing Black Lives Matter t-shirts and holding the signs than you actually see black people with the signs and t-shirts.
That's kind of like what Bill Burr was saying.
The movement's been hijacked by like the far left, right? And I'm talking like the far left, like the Antifa type people. Right. They're using it. And then like you said, the two women that founded it, when you actually look at their views, they took a great slogan, which if it was done properly, would actually mean something really, really well. And when you dig deep, it's like you could actually see that the actual organization, Black Lives Matter, could get listed with Antifa as a domestic terrorist organization.
100%.
And that's crazy because they got the greatest slogan you can have for the movement. You know what I mean?
It's like a Marxist ideology. It's almost like the way Karl Marx, his deal was to like prey on like the weakest people.
Yeah.
So you have all these people like going out to all these protests and everything, like getting arrested, doing all this stuff. And then like the next group will come up on the backs of these people will start the next fight and the next fight and the next fight. And the whole thing is to just crush.
And then the message is lost.
Right. The message has changed.
Yeah.
Because you see it goes from Black Lives Matter to BLM to whatever else that comes after that. Because then people, if you ask the average 19-year-old what BLM stands for, they won't even know.
You see? Really?
That's how it would change.
Crazy. I don't think that now.
Dude, 100%. Like, dude, these kids, attention span, like, they don't know what anything. If you ask somebody why they don't like Trump, the first thing they're going to tell you is, he's racist.
He's racist. Yeah. I'll tell you right now. Watching those videos, like those interviewers on YouTube, and they go around like rallies and they start like interviewing Trump supporters or the non-Trump supporters. Yeah. Hilarious.
Yeah, it is
how ignorant people are. Well,
and that's what's crazy because that's the number one thing. That's the big knock against Trump is that everybody says he's racist. But then they just started pulling all this stuff the past couple weeks about Biden and his history.
Dude,
His vice presidential running mate called him out during the debates for the Democratic nomination, saying, he supported the side that said, no, let's not bus people in from other places. But she literally called him out. I just watched the clip the other day. She goes, you tried to keep someone like me from getting a good education. And the man had nothing to say. He just stood there and took it during it. And now she's his running mate.
Yeah, he called black people monkeys. And he didn't want his kids going to school in the zoo type shit.
Yeah. He said jungle. His direct quote was, I don't want to raise my kids in a jungle or something like that. And you're like, damn. And then you're on Charlemagne's show and you say, if you don't vote for me, you ain't black. Yeah. When I heard him say that, I was like, oh man, that was bad.
Dude, he did a lot more work. He did a lot worse shit. Like, dude, this is not his first time running for president. The last time, I think it was in the 80s, he like lied about like college. He was like, yeah, I graduated like, you know, top 3 in my class. And he's like, man, more like 83.
Yo, and then
he dropped out.
And his son's a crackhead.
Yeah, dude, that's crackhead shit. He left his computer. He left his computer at the porn shop or whatever. And then, like, he's like, oh shit, did I wipe the hard drive?
Nope.
Fuck it. I'll buy another one. And then dude was like, yo, you sure you don't want to do it? He was like, nah, it's all right. He was like, damn.
Yeah, that's definitely some crackhead
shit. That's some crackhead shit. You have to go get high.
I don't know. Like I said, I think I can't wait to see how this all turns out after tomorrow, whenever we finally get, if we even get the answer tomorrow, because they're saying we might not have the answer for a couple days or whatever. I can't wait to see how it turns out. You know.
So what's worst case scenario for you, you think?
Yeah, I think the worst case scenario, especially for me, okay,
yeah,
is that the country really goes into unrest. People start really going crazy, whichever side wins or loses, right? I, sitting here being a felon for my DWI, can't even arm myself with a weapon. You know what I mean? Best thing I could do is have a freaking steak knife in my house. You know, God forbid, shit pops off.
Yeah.
Like that, for me, that's the scariest part, is if this country does go into some type of a civil war, if it does go, and I can see it going kind of that way. I mean, police aren't even doing nothing in Philadelphia. There's letting the riots happen right now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So imagine it pops off here in Albany. The police say, okay, we're backing out right now and waiting for this thing to kind of calm itself down. How do I protect myself? I can't have a gun.
Well, it's almost like the perfect storm, how things have been going with the riots, with police brutality, and the police being like, you know, defund the police. They're almost, I don't say scared to react, but they're more hesitant to react because, right, that, you know, everybody's pointing the finger, how many police are losing their jobs and stuff like that. Just for example, now we're ending the year 2020, the year that's going to go down in infamy right now, with this presidential election that is going to set the country into an unrest, more or less. It's going to divide us even more. I feel we have not been a country united in quite some time. I mean, when was the last time
9/11?
You saw, yeah, 9/11. Jesus.
Actually, no. The last time I saw it, 9/11 was a good time, but also when
it was a good time.
No, I mean, like, reunited. But no, it was on your wedding, actually, on the cruise ship when we got Osama bin Laden and Obama came out and
my wedding was shadowed in that.
But yeah, it's hilarious that it happened on it was your wedding day, right? It was the actual day?
I believe so.
But when we got them, the whole country, people started gathering in place all over the country. We were stuck on a cruise ship. The whole cruise ship was going nuts. People were going to the White House in D.C. and rallying because we did something together as a country, right? Caught the guy who was in.
When was the last time?
Six dudes did that shit. We didn't
do it. When was the last time you guys can remember, you know,
those six dudes wrecked for all of us.
The hate people have for their president. Like, I mean, people have always voted one way or voted another way. But when was the last time you remember, like, somebody lost, like, you're the guy you voted for lost, and you're like, he lost.
But Jason,
now it's people screaming. That shouldn't have happened.
Let me tell you this, brother. It's always been like this. It's just we get more information faster now. Think about it, bro. Like we're all 37. You remember like being in the barracks and like, you know, living in the barracks, even in base training, like everybody had these different opinions. And then we just like either didn't talk to each other or just like tease each other about shit like presidential views. But now you see all your friends and you're like, dude, like, why does this dude talk about politics so much?
When Obama was elected, did you hear people screaming and fighting in the streets?
What? Yes. But not like this.
Because, I guess that's what I'm saying. Like, this is the first time. This is the first
pandemic because of COVID. Right.
This is the first time I saw somebody get elected.
I mean, in the past 4 years. That's the COVID.
This is the first time I saw somebody get elected and then people blatantly say, that's not my president. And you want to be like, well, you can say what you want, but technically he is your president. Yeah. Like, imagine you guys, again, I'll use you guys as the example, being in the military. He's technically your boss. He is your commander in chief.
100%.
You imagine, by the way, is there repercussions? What if somebody in the military says, that's not my president, vocally, like on social media or something? Yeah, can they be in trouble for that?
No, they do. Oh. People do it all the time. I don't even want to go there with this because it's so funny. Like the way it is people can have so much of an opinion. Like you're right. You shouldn't be able to denounce the president, dude. Regardless of what you think, it's so weakness. Just like Kanye said something brilliant. He goes, when we have our debates, it should be closed circuit to people only in this country. It's like having a fight having like a something happen in your house. So we should let the whole world see our debates.
That makes sense.
And that makes sense, bro, because it's like, just like with the military, like, if you don't like President Trump, like, you shouldn't even be allowed to say anything because, like, you're like, that, to me, that shows weakness.
Do you think other countries look at our politics as, like, reality TV?
100%.
Like, our president is a reality TV star.
Touche.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, of course, we're right now, unfortunately, we are definitely the reality TV show that the rest of the world is watching. The good thing is we're still the guy.
We're still going to be us. Yeah.
Yeah.
They love us.
And that is the one thing I think, at least as Americans, if everybody holds that together, like, hey, we're still the place everybody wants to come to. We're still the place everybody wants to be and all that. I think we'll be all right. But here's the thing. This is a real freak out thing I've thought about recently, too, though, with our country. Like, we might really go to war with China. They're saying it's like the only way to get rid of the debt. I don't want
to
say.
Oh, like to take it?
Like
we owe that money.
We owe $23 trillion. So it's like.
So, yo, we're not paying y'all. If y'all want to fight,
by the way,
fight,
but we're not that'd be y'all. The ultimate American gangster stories. If we say, you know what? Screw you and your $23 trillion.
Yeah, we're not paying y'all. Yeah, that should be crazy. All right. Time to move on. Jason had a topic. Tipping.
What's your take on tipping?
I'll tip. So my tip always starts at 35%, right? 35%.
That's the lowest you'd get a tip.
Yeah. No. That's the highest.
Oh, the highest. Okay.
Right. But that ceiling of 30, that, like that 35%, for it to get down to 30 or even 25, very easy.
Right. So you tip on service.
100% on service. Okay. But like, I'll leave no tip.
All right.
Ooh, right. I've never done that.
Yeah, I do that. And I let them know. Oh, I write it on the receipt. No tip because.
At least you don't know. Now, well, I know Eric stands because Eric worked. Now, did you ever work in any type of food service or any type of industry?
Yes.
What'd you do?
I worked for a moving company and I knew how to get a tip.
Okay. Well, instantly my mind goes towards like waiter.
Oh, I've never worked
waitress.
No.
But a moving company. All right.
I worked for a moving company and I did meeting services at the Hampton Inn.
Now, you were a foodist, you were actually a waiter, and so many people I know who were waiters, are waiters, waitresses, are bar staff, especially bar staff, they always like, you tip well, I don't care, because I know what it was like, and they throw wads of cash. Is that you, Eric?
That is me. I tip, I'm a really good tipper, sometimes too good of a tipper. No, listen, I worked at Denny's, all right, in the worst Denny's too, the one that used to be on Central Ave. In our area here, right next, there was one right down the road from Sneaky Pete's, and I worked the overnight shift a lot, right? And so we got all
the business time.
Yep, we got all the drunk club people coming afterwards, and
Sneaky's.
And Sneaky Pete's, and they were the worst tippers. Literally, they would look at you in your face and say, oh no, you keep the change. And you look at the thing, you're like, that's 63 cents. There's 8 of you.
Damn.
And I got a 60, so I ain't gonna lie.
Are you talking bad about black people like that, Eric?
By the way, I didn't say they were black. How did you know that they were black? I said nothing about that. No, everybody did it. And because I got such bad tips at Denny's, I did not work there very long. I ended up getting fired for drinking.
So you're fired from Denny's for being drunk. Everybody at Denny's was drunk.
Yeah. So because of getting all them poor tips, I tip very well. So for me, I do more of, I don't have a percentage system. I do this. It's more of kind of like in my head. I'm like, okay, I'm starting automatically. If it's just me out to lunch by myself and I'm spending about $20, right? I'm putting a $10 tip down. So what is that? 30%?
That's 50%.
No, it's like 30th.
Yeah, 50%.
Yeah,
50%. It's $20.
Yeah. Yep. And so if me and the wife go out, we go out to dinner, it's like an $80 bill or whatever. I'm putting $120 down.
Right, 50%. Yeah.
Oh. So yeah, I guess I'm about 50%. Yeah,
but that's what celebrities do.
Yeah, but here's the thing. Now, if it's bad service, then that's when I leave. Like the basic double the tax tip. So they still get a decent.
So you go from 50
to 16%.
Yeah.
Is there a bit in between?
That's pretty much what it is. So if you suck, and by the way, the worst part is now that I'm thinking about it, as you guys are bringing this to life right here. They're getting that 16% tip, like,
Must have did all right.
So now, and you're still, it's still in the industry you're in now, you still get tips.
Yeah, yeah, I get tipped.
So do they tip you $1,000, 50%?
No, they do not. But usually when I get tipped, it's like $200. So
now that's 100%. So that kind of, and I guess my turn, I do tip. I absolute tip. I throw, you know, every time I get a drink at the bar, I'm going to throw a dollar or two down. If I'm getting, you know, the more drinks I order, or if it's like a, you know, like three mixed drinks or something like that, I'll throw a few more dollars down. Of course, I know the person, I'll throw probably more than what the drinks are worth.
Yeah.
When waiters and waitresses, I usually do the standard unless they go above and beyond, and then I'm glad to give a little more. So I'm like you, Miles. I'll give more.
Just so we know, the standard tip is 20%.
Oh, is it really?
Well, you know another reason why I tip so high?
I just thought it was a team.
It's not even just the fact that I know what it's like. Do you guys know? A lot of people think that, well, hey, the guy's still getting paid to be here. My tip's extra.
Right.
The minimum wage
is $6.
The minimum wage for the service industry is different than minimum wage for the guy who works at Walmart.
Is that fair, though, that the employer gets to pay them much less and we have to make up the difference?
It is fair.
And that's an American thing, because in Europe, that's... They pay them $15 an hour.
I think that's in Australia, like tipping is like looked at as shame.
A lot of Europeans shunned up, like they don't tip. But
in America, a lot of companies can't afford to pay employees. So you say, okay, I'm going to give you this and like the service to earn it, the rest of their money. So like now I don't have to pay them and now I can have wonderful service and like they'll work for their service based on what they get.
And listen, as a server, you're judging the table.
Except for the people that get shunned, where you know it's like I'm gonna work harder because I'm gonna get tipped more.
Yeah.
Unless they get shunned, you know, and then the ones who feel as though the person's not working that great, right? Like, you know, this person sucks. You're still gonna give them 8-20%, 18-20%.
But bro, there's no way in the world that you could be good at serving and not earn and not kill.
Fair enough. Now, but that rolls into this part. So you and thank you for bringing up. Well, you know, the server only makes X amount of dollars. That's true. But say you go get a massage. I thought about this. So you go get a massage and you're paying, I don't know, $100-$120 for, you know, your hour long massage. Some places are less, some places are more. I know. So you're paying $120 this person. Now I've gone to places where it's $120 in your pocket. So Eric, I am going to pay you $2,000 to be my DJ. It's going into your pocket. That's it. You're not getting paid any less because you are the owner.
Right.
I'm going to pay you $2,000. So now I'm supposed to give you more or a massage. Hey, you set the price at $120. Here's my $120. Wait, you don't give that person an extra $50? That means it's a $170 massage.
Yeah, no. So that's actually funny to bring up massages, because massages, I do get a couple a year and I usually tip them like $10 or $20 total and my bill's like $100. So I'm tipping them way differently than I tip people in the service industry. Because I know for a fact that either A, they get paid per massage. If you work at John Paul, I think they take half or whatever, something like that. So they're getting paid pretty good for that hour already.
Well, and that's what I was saying. Like, where do you draw the line? So you'll tip at Denny's, but you won't tip at McDonald's.
It's where it's hard.
You know, you'll tip at the bar when somebody opens up a drink and hands it to you. Mm-hmm. But do you tip at Dunkin' Donuts when they hand you your coffee? I mean, they have that little cup in front.
Making the coffee
is a lot harder than cracking open your can of, you know, beer.
No, you know what? At Dunkin' Donuts, I just do the keep and change thing. I pull that move.
But why?
The same thing that person did to you?
I feel the server is stuck with me. I've taken up that table. Remember, a server only gets like 3 to 5 tables. So,
right. What about a bartender? Bartender's stuck with you?
No, bartenders, I tip good. I tip bartenders.
And that's what I'm kind of getting.
I don't drink no more, but when I did.
So you walk up and you drink a soda, you're still going to give the bartender a dollar. No different than you.
Oh, right? Yeah.
Okay. So you still drink liquids.
I don't tip just a dollar, though.
Oh, so when you go to a restaurant and you, like, for lunch and you pick up your food and, like, they try to print the receipt and it has tip on it, you still put tip?
Okay,
now that's zero. Different.
Yeah.
Oh, so when you do, when you do curbside delivery.
Yeah. Curbside delivery. If they're watching me fill it out because they're sitting there, I put like $2 or $3 on
there. That's a self-esteem thing, bro.
If they're not watching me, I ain't going to lie, zero, and I sign it and go, all right, have a good day.
I put zero.
I just zero.
I feel like I'm a horrible tipper, Miles.
What? Bro, they didn't do anything for me.
Well, they bagged it up.
Oh, come on, bro.
The curbside person, you know what their job is to do? Their job is to actually go in the back. They're the ones that bag it, put it in the styrofoam to-go things and all that.
I wish we would have researched this, because just like when we talk about like social media and how they strategically plan that algorithm to piss you off and get what you need to do, the tip being on that curbside pickup thing, and even when you go in the store and pick it up, that's rude, bro. Like, they put that there. Even that cup at Dunkin' Donuts is rude.
Well, it's no different than the places, I think, that slip the tip, like, on the bill. They don't say nothing. They automatically add it in there.
And then if you're not paying attention, and you add more.
And you add more. Or, like you just said, what if the person's a shitty server? This was a terrible server, but I'm automatically, you're telling me I have to give you.
So now here's some empathy, because my sister, she's a server, and she'll hear this, and she'll be like, you're crazy. How about when you go out to a bar and it's like a group and they go separate checks? I think that's kind of fucked up.
I don't. You not know? Nowadays. Not with the point of sale system these days. And but then again, I am ignorant to. I've never been that guy.
When is it too much?
I think it's too much if you tell them after the fact. Tell them ahead of time it's okay.
I don't think it's okay. I think, like, with more than four people, you should figure it out. Because, dude, like, imagine Lady Bird.
It's always an argument.
18 people. Hell no. You need to choose a different group of friends there. Because, like, you ever been, like, a big group of, like, 18 or 20 people, and, like, this lady has to sit there and do.
I tell you right now, I've never not been screwed, or unfortunately, may have actually screwed somebody out of paying them.
All the time.
If three of us went out to get a bite to eat, someone's getting the shaft.
Nah, you're bugging. Just split it in three.
Perfect. Somebody just got, you just proved somebody got the shaft. Right?
Yeah. In my drinking heyday, just going out to lunch with me, you get screwed if you just split it in half, because I put down five drinks quick.
So, all right. So
it's actually happening to this guy right here.
So I was out, we were out on vacation a year or two ago. We're down in Florida, Key West, group of us, eight, maybe 10 of us.
Right.
Whatever, 8 or 10, it was couples. So it was either 4 or 5 couples. And numerous times during this vacation while we were there, I would kind of get like the simple meal because I didn't want to go crazy. I didn't want to be rude. I felt weird. Yeah. Let me get the lobster. Let me get four lobsters. I wanted to get weird. So this one time we went to, it was a steakhouse. It was one of the probably most expensive restaurants we went to on our trip. It was the most expensive restaurant we went to on our trip. We were down in Key West, which says something. It's an expensive area. I looked over at the one guy who was just, you know, who's known for getting whatever he wanted. And he got I think it was like a $34 steak. So I said, fuck yeah, I'm doing the same thing. In fact, I think I upped it to $36 and appetizers. I easily, my meal alone with my drink was probably $55, $60 by myself. And I didn't feel bad about yourself. It. I looked down and see the woman getting a salad because she's on a diet. I'm sitting there getting a $57 steak.
Well, you know what the worst part, though, is about when you split it evenly? Because that's what ends up happening when you have a bigger group. Everybody goes, because nobody wants to do the math. People have had some drinks. So it's like, split it five ways.
Sure.
And you went in with the mindset that you were just going to pay for yours. So like you said, you went cheap and all of a sudden went, oh shit, we're splitting it five ways evenly. Yep. Damn it.
If I knew that afterwards, I wouldn't have held back. So, I was holding back a little bit.
Play yourself, right? Play myself. Podcast. This is what
show.
This is about.
Play myself. Show.
Oh shit.
Caught you.
Ooh. I'm editing that shit. Fucking my ego. I always order what I want. And like, I never watch anybody because I look at it like, look, it comes down to like who you are. Why would I be at dinner if I'm not going to have what I want? Now, when it comes to drinks, people can be a little obsessive with that. So I feel like after two drinks, it's like, your drinks are on your own shit.
But then you got to be that guy sitting, excuse me, everybody. Yeah. I know there's 9 people at this table right now, but I need to make an announcement. Y'all stop fucking drinking.
Nah.
You know, exactly. You just suck up a bitch about the way home. Like everybody else does.
I feel like it's curious to, after like your second drink, you say, hey guys, I know we split this in half, but dude, I drank so much.
For me, I've gone for lunch. That's what gets me. So dinner's one thing, order what you want, eat what you want. For me, sometimes it's lunch. And I'm like, I don't want to sit there. It's a lunch. I'm not going to drop $25 on lunch. I don't want to at least drop. So I might get something small. We get a wrap. Oh, there's a lunch special for $8.99. That's great. Okay, $8.99. Well, then also, hey, we're going to split the bill. Everybody just throw in, here, we're going to split each way. That's $17. Like, I spent $8.99 on the lunch menu because I'm trying to, I'm not trying to spend $700 a month by ordering $20 meals every single day.
So let me take this conversation a different way.
Go ahead.
First date. So you go on a date with a female.
Yep.
Is it cool to go Dutch?
Yo, so I...
It was like a weakness for us. Like, back in the day, I was never
from experience, not personal experience, but...
Eric wants the girl to buy.
Eric goes,
she died.
Eric goes, I can speak from experience, not personal experience.
How do you pick that up?
My daughter just told me she went out with a guy the other day, and she paid for her portion, and he thought it was weird. He's also her age, 18, 19, and he actually thought it was weird, like, you were going to chip out, I was going to cover. She said, no, I'll pay for my part because she's independent, right? And she's got money. He actually thought it was weird. What I took from that was even this younger generation feels like, yo, if you're going on a date, the guy's got to pay. And by the way, let me tell you, when you're going on a date, it would make sense if you're trying to impress the girl to tip big that day. Don't take advice from Miles on this one.
No, but listen to this.
Unless she looks at it just the opposite. She's like, wow, you're just throwing your money away?
Right. And I got two rebuttals to that. So one, this girl was like just going on Tinder dates just to eat. And then my second one is the expectation, right? So like, I think that when you go on a date and like people might feel like, yo, I bought you dinner. You owe me.
Oh, you ordered lobster? That's right.
Right. Because like you always get that expression like, yo, you pay for the pussy no matter what.
So I'm telling you right now, if her new boyfriend is listening, if you think like that, I will fuck you up.
So he's actually
a cool kid. Actually, I got to talk to him on FaceTime. He was actually really cool.
So to answer your first question in regards to paying for dates, I feel as though if I'm inviting you out to eat, if I'm actually done with friends, if I'm going to take you and invite you, hey, come out to eat. I'm talking to you and like, come out to eat. I'll pay. You know, friends, someone I'm trying to date or anything like that, even when I was younger. What I like to do, though, was rather than go out to a restaurant and eat, I'd cook. That I thought was the best thing. So, hey, why don't we go back? We want to do a dinner and a movie. But end up being, I'm going to cook a dinner, we talk, hang out, and then afterwards, we're going to watch a movie at my place.
Then we go fuck. Jason,
yeah.
How are you going to say, like, if you can get a girl to come over your house to eat dinner, like, that's better, bro.
You know what I mean? Like, thank you.
Ryan, take that note, buddy.
No, but to go out.
Keep that in mind, Ryan.
You know, on a date, that's kind of like, all right, this is like the safe zone or whatever like that. But if you can get a girl to come over your house.
Let me ask you this. Does the girl feel obligated? Or does she go, hey, thanks for the dinner and the movie. See you later.
That's up to her.
Like I said,
back in my day, it's basically like, if you have the wine, you have everything right, like only you can fuck that up.
Exactly. A clean house, yeah. A good meal.
Yeah.
When we're seeing the house is clean, you can cook, and then you go put a movie. They didn't even need a movie. The movie was just background noise.
Yeah. This is before the camera phone.
But rolling into something else you said in regards to that girl who was doing the Tinder just to get meals.
Yeah.
I had a philosophy, and I still kind of do to this day. And I'm married, so it doesn't really stick as much as it did when I was single. Sleep. But I never really bought girls drinks. I knew too many female friends that would come up, would go out together, and they would literally go out and get guys to buy them drinks and then come over and share that, like, oh, hey, I got two. Here's one for you. Or they'd be like, I need a drink. And I'm like, well, I'll get it. Oh, don't worry. I got someone who's buying me drinks. So, and they'd go flirt with the guy, get a drink, come back. So I saw behind the curtain, and it really opened my eyes. I'm like, well, fuck that. So I've had too many girls come up and go, hey, why don't you buy me a drink? And I'm like, no. Now I will buy friends drinks. I will have a girl that we've been talking to, and she's got her own drink. I'm like, you know what? Hey, let me get the next one. But girls just walk up, go buy me a drink, forget it.
I got one.
Biggest turn off.
So here's a great one. So when me and my wife, I think we were just friends. I don't think we were dating yet at this time.
So that's how it really starts, yeah.
No. But me, her, and I don't remember which friend it was that went out with us of hers, but I go, girls, watch this. I saw two marks, these two dudes sitting at the bar. I walk up to the dudes. I go, yo, hey, guys, these girls are a little nervous. They told me to come talk to them. They wanted you to buy them a drink. The guy's like, oh, yeah. So the girls come over, they're buying drinks, and yo, we rang up these motherfuckers' tab, right? And I don't know how much, I know this, I was drunk, the girls were drunk, the girls went with me, obviously my wife left with me, her friend came with me, and them guys were just probably left scratching their heads like, what the hell just happened?
Sucker shit. We did it at Maxie's.
Mark.
We were at Maxie's on the patio, me and you, and we started talking at this table, and girls, this was back when I was living on Hackett, so that was a long time ago. We were talking to these girls up at a table. They came over and sat with us. And then this guy by himself, and Max's is right in that hotel district. So he had a lot of businessmen. So he wanted to join our group. So we invited them over because he started, you know, let me buy you guys a drink. We're like, sure, come on over, buy us a drink. So then he started buying the drinks. So we went on. He said, put it on my tab. So Eric and I didn't hold back. We got tanked.
But you know what, though? Part of that, though, I think and I'm not trying to say like that the guy was like a sucker or whatever, but like part of that is being in a new city and like people acknowledging you, like that shit goes a long way. Like just being a good person. Like
He was just flexing money.
And
Eric said the same exact thing.
Oh, gentlemen, if you're on your first date, you better make sure you tip well.
That's just flexing.
Oh.
I got this. Let me throw this out.
Every time I go to an airport and I get the Joe Jacking with somebody, dude, they always pay for my drink. Regardless of what it is, like, it could be a guy or a girl.
I've done that. I don't know specifically at an air.
I've paid it back.
Yeah.
You guys know who Joey Diaz is?
I love Joey Diaz.
So Joey Diaz had like he always gives like good wisdom, right? So he said today like in like if you're a comic, if you're a DJ, if you're a car salesman, whatever you are, it's not only the service business but it's the karma business. Shit always gonna come back to you when you need it or when you don't need it. So
100%.
Yeah. So he said like when you fucking if you need a drink, if somebody buys you a drink and you buy somebody a drink, like that shit comes back and then like you might need like to get into a door one day or need some other shit. He said like that's like the balance business. When I do in the service.
I do that with driving. I'm one of those karma guys in driving. I will stop and let somebody pull out. If somebody's gonna take a right and like there's a light going on and I'm like, you know, there's a intersection without an intersection without light, I will stop and let that person. I always feel there's karma with driving.
Karma is huge, and I think it's the only reason I still have a career in the DJ industry is because I had these past couple of years where I've been kind of screwing up really bad with my drinking. The one thing is I always gave new DJs their shot and I always took care of my friends that were DJs like as best I could. Oh, you need a speaker for the speaker? Come take it, whatever. I wasn't one of the guys like rental, like because there's a lot of guys in my industry. It's like, oh, you want to borrow that? Yeah, just throw me $100. Yeah. I never did none of that.
But that's bitten you in the ass. And we could go into a whole.
That's why I mean that's because check it out right now. I have, and I won't put names out there because I don't want to name drop. I got one of the top guys on the radio right now hit me up, helping him out with finding DJs for other things. So now I'm plugging DJs back in again. I got one of the top DJs, this I can say, coming to my house tomorrow to do a live stream with me. And he's a guy that when I actually remember, I actually told a story on my YouTube channel recently how I got fired from a DJ gig was when I got drunk at Philly's.
Right.
And got fired on the spot during it because I was so drunk. I was out, right? Well, the guy who put me on is the guy who's coming to do my Twitch stream tomorrow. And it's because I attributed the karma. One, I'm clean now, but two, I was so apologetic and humble about it when it happened. And he really said, he goes, bro, it's happened to all of us. Don't worry. I'll get you back on over there. Da, da, da. You know, no big deal. It's all about karma.
Everything he's saying right there has nothing to do with what I was talking about, by the way. That was a good plug. Yeah, hey, absolutely. Plug your show. That was good to the, yeah, talk about how you're apologetic.
Karma's going to come back and fight you for that one.
What I was trying to say was, you said I've always helped people out. I've always let them borrow my stuff and never charged them.
Yeah.
And I said, I can bitch and ask because how many times my stuff was stolen and pawned, stolen and broken.
That was numerous. That was when I went to jail.
You let them use the stuff.
I did not let them.
Okay, just recently you let somebody borrow a projector and you had to hunt him down for a week and call him every day to get it.
Why'd you point at me?
No, I just pointed. I'm talking with my hands.
I'm somebody.
Yeah,
you are somebody.
There are a few times.
That's all I'm saying.
How many doors have been opened because I've always helped people out? How many people have bailed me out of my situations, like when I went to jail and covered all my gigs because I always helped people out?
They covered your gigs because they took advantage and they took your stuff that was worth more than what their gigs payment would have been.
All right, guys.
And that's what I said. We could go to a whole hour conversation.
By the way, this is our segment of where we shit on Eric once a week.
Stop making it so fucking easy.
Here's a top, and it's so great that you guys are so great friends, because like I know like if there was ever something like that, I would never have a show again because like you guys can talk. What is one thing like rule that you have for the house, be it like when you first got your own apartment or like when you just had to have girls?
Like take off the shoes rule type thing, or are we talking like rule
that
thing?
Got you late? Like mine was like no pants on my bed. Like if you were into my bed.
Kind of creepy shit are you into?
I was thinking the same thing. I was like,
can we talk about this during the Me Too movement right now?
I'm just saying, like, dude,
where is that work? Well, I've been with my wife since I was I got with her when I was 21. So we're dating it back. So I got to really think here. But
where really got you laid with Lisa? It was probably just like, oh, I'm sorry, you have to do at least 3 shots before you come in the front door.
Oh, that was one I heard of, like somebody say, oh, if you come in the room, you have to do a shot.
I don't think I had any of those weird, like, things.
I didn't have any rules for the people, like for the women that came over. But I think rules in general was always kept a clean place. It was never dirty, but it might have been messy. So that way I could clean up in a matter of minutes, like pick up in a matter of minutes because somebody's coming over. Even when we were kids, when we were kids, we'd go to my place because in a matter of minutes we'd be clean. I always kept condoms scattered throughout the house.
Scattered.
I swear, like, I never had to go more than 3 feet without having to find a condom. Like in this room alone, I'd probably have one set on that shelf there. There'd be some over there and there'd be probably like right around the corner. So I never actually like leave the room, go looking for them. I just had to like reach. From any point in my any kitchen everywhere.
By the way, I can attest to that because when I was like 16 or 17, you and your family were away on vacation and I got Drew because Drew Barone had the keys to your parents' house to let your dog out,
right? Yeah, he was at my
parents' house. I go, Drew, I got this girl, man. I need the key to Jay's house, blah, blah, blah. And I went down to his room that used to be in the basement, found a condom instantly, smashed this girl in the basement.
That was rule in a car. Kept them in certain spots in the car. Always needed them. That was my like my rule. And candles.
Always have a candle.
I had candles everywhere.
You didn't have any rules like all the shit you're talking about. Like is like
I never brought a girl to my place because it was always messy.
So it was dirty
places.
It was dirty. He was 25 years.
Like, make your bed or anything?
Make my bed. He didn't even have a bed. Sometimes
you know what I made my bed? Basic training in prison. That's it.
Shit.
Well, I think the cleanest his apartment was when I moved in with him for what 3 months. It was only a few, but it was months. It wasn't even a year.
2 months, yeah.
But that's it. Oh, jeez, yeah. I thought it was a little more of that. I moved in. I showed up. I said, "Here, I'm gonna give you." I think it was like $400. His rent was like $600. I said, "I'm gonna give you $400. I want that." It was a 1-bedroom apartment. It was a 2-room apartment, not including the bathroom.
He's in a movie. She's like,
"I want that room right there. You can have the living room. The kitchen is fine, and the bathroom's fine." And here's your $400. That's all I'm giving you. And Eric's like, okay. I mean, he wasn't paying rent. He wasn't paying any bills. He put the money right in his pocket. But we cleaned. I showed up like, yo, this place is nasty. We gotta clean. But because we cleaned, we would start bringing girls back to the place to include your now wife.
Yep.
Damn.
Yeah.
Jason got you your wife.
I guess helped in a way.
Because if she would have
came back there. He got me back and he got me my wife. So we're even.
Because if she would have came back there and the place was dirty, she probably
luckily, me and my wife were very similar. I mean, they're very similar. My wife likes cleaning a clean house. Obviously, everybody likes a clean house. Who doesn't like clean house?
But now,
me and my wife just hate cleaning.
Right. No, but now
one goes.
But if she would have got there and the place was dirty,
maybe she might have left. Well, on top of that, I was fighting against the guy. Well, I knew this at the time because me and her were friends. We were actually friends for a while. So I was competing against the guy. No bullshit. Who apparently has an 8-inch dick and knows how to throw it down. That's what I had to compete with. All right. So I had
fucked already.
Huh?
Fucked already.
Oh yeah, because she was trying to. She didn't want to be with him. She was trying to be with him, and so I tried to play it off like I was talking to other girls too. Meanwhile, I was trying to get in. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I don't know. I guess I just got the gift of gab, and he don't.
No, he definitely
got the gift of gab. Won over the 8-inch cock.
And that's the segue for just 3 seconds of awkward silence.
So, hey, you guys hear Sean Connery died?
James Bond, everyone.
James Bond, I can't believe that.
No, with him, though. Did you know? Okay, do you know when he retired? Officially retired?
I didn't even know he did.
So you know? Do you know when he retired? Like what year?
Probably 2000 or something.
And so, well, what 2019, 2010,
2015,
2006.
Six. Okay.
2006. He has not been around. He's been around, but he's not done a movie since 2006. He came out of retirement.
Wait, what was his last movie?
What was his last one? I had it. He came out of retirement in 2012 to do a voiceover for a kid's like cartoon skit.
Well, you guys are looking that up. I'll tell you my favorite Sean Connery movie.
The Rock?
Why do you have to say it? Yes, that's exactly what I was going to say. I mean, he was so good in that movie. When he did the thing where he's getting his hair cut
and he's convincing him to get just, you know,
dude, I don't remember that.
How in Zeus's butthole did you get out of here? And then he literally slings something over the dude's wrist and holds him over the balcony. I was like,
oh. Was it an 8-inch cock? Call a callback.
By the way, do not isolate that. I can see that already. That's going to end up in the intro.
No, yeah.
But, yo, that was my favorite. The Rock, that movie.
Indiana Jones.
Indiana Jones was my favorite.
He was good in Indiana Jones.
Jones is kind of trash.
What? Indiana Jones?
First of all, do you remember Indiana Jones? They made through him. You get him at McDonald's. I remember that's where I bought him.
You got the VHS?
Yeah, the VHS tapes. They sold them at McDonald's.
Yo, you know what's crazy about that? Did you guys watch that McDonald's documentary?
Hell yeah, I did.
Do you see how
McMillions?
How they used to sell those shit?
Yeah.
Yo.
Not a single person, Uncle Jerry, not a single person went. The mob was involved big time. Whoa. There were hits.
By the way, I always knew it was pretty impossible to win that, but I did not know there was a chance you could buy your way in. That is crazy. It went on for years.
You guys left Sean real quick. That's sad. The man died 2 days ago.
Well, you're looking up
this. I think you care about
that. I do. I think it actually knows funny, and she may hear it or not. Yo, it really affected my wife. It's real, like, she needed a moment. I'm like, you okay? She goes, I just need a moment right now.
The man was old.
I swear to say he was 92?
And 91?
I mean, think about it. He was old. My first movie I remember him in was, I don't remember him from James Bond. I mean, I saw him as an older. No. My first movie I remember him in was Indiana Jones. And he was old. He was playing the father.
So his last movie, his last big blockbuster movie, we'll say, was The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
You remember that?
Was good. Yeah, that was good. 2003.
I forgot.
But Jason, and then in 2005, he did a voiceover for the James Bond from Russia with Love PlayStation 2 video game.
Hilarious.
Then he did nothing. And then he did a voiceover for some straight to film, you know, cartoon or something like that. Actually, it wasn't a kid's movie. It was NR. So not rated.
Jason, do you think that, is your wife one of those people that, like, she's generally empathetic to the world?
No,
she had a real affliction for Sean Connery.
Oh no, she had like a little girl crush on Sean Connery.
Because
we were playing a game and it was like one of those, like, you have to guess the word without saying the word. Right. And the word was Scottish. Right. And she's like, who's the guy I love the most, right? And actor I love the most? Sean Connery. His accent.
Oh wow.
That was a week ago.
See, sometimes, like, especially with females, that they'll have like an affliction for an idea rather than, like, you know.
No, for a person. I think there's just something. Same thing with Robin Williams. And that kind of goes saying, I feel Sean Connery, and the reason I asked, like, hey, do you remember when he stopped acting, when he got out, which was actually, I said 2006, but his last real movie was 2003, so 17 years ago. But he is such a household name. He's a name that there's movies still air, all, you know, often enough on TV, or there's a movie that you want to play.
When they do the Jeopardy skits with the guy who plays Sean Connery, right.
They do the skits for him.
Yeah. And I want to believe that that's how Sean Connery is in real life, is the guy who's always playing him in them skits on SNL. You know, so fuck your wife, Trevor. You know, in my mind, I'm like, that's probably how Sean Connery really
So what do you guys think about, like, retirement then?
Because, like,
I think it's going to happen sooner than most.
No, for us, maybe, right? You know, our RBG. She died, right?
The judge.
And Sean Connery.
Yep. Right?
And this is what brings this idea to my mind. It's like, right, Sean Connery, he retired, you know, in his 70s, maybe. 70s or 70s or 80s.
Late 70s.
Late 70s. But yeah. Dude, it's pretty late. You know what I mean? But like same with her. When do you want to just be like, all right, I'm just going to be like, because he didn't need money.
Well,
Sarah Ginsburg
never retired.
Yeah, she didn't want to. And Obama tried to make her retire.
And Sean Connery retired doing what he loved, though. I mean, he did it for so long. If you're doing something forever, Eric, you're who do you listen to all the time? Who do you love?
Eminem. Howard Stern.
And how long has Howard Stern been doing?
And Eminem.
Eminem's doing it for 20 years.
Yeah. Howard Stern's been going, they say, like
50.
35
you're
years.
You're fucking 50.
Huh?
50 years.
He ain't been doing it 50 years. Him and Robin got together.
No. I watched the Private Parts movie, and he was DJing before Robin.
Yeah, in the 70s, bro.
But not long before that. It's been like 35. He's 60-something years old.
I'm
tell you how old. He's 60-something years old.
I'll look it up.
So he was in his 20s when he started.
in college. He started in college. No, he got on the college radio station.
That's true.
Tell him my
house. So he's 60. He's 66.
I know more about Howard than you do.
No, you do not. You know what? Ask me a Howard question right now. Go ahead.
What?
Ask me a Howard Stern question right now.
You serious?
Yeah. You better know the answer too, though.
I do. Okay. I know a lot about Howard Stern.
Go ahead.
All right. What was the name of his first wife?
It was, I feel like it was Heather. Is it Heather?
So,
you didn't talk about his first wife, but what was it? what was her name? What was her name?
Howard Stern's first wife?
Yeah.
What's his, hold on, I'll give you, I'll show you something.
Beth is his wife now.
Okay.
Beth Ostrowski.
Beth Ostrowski is his wife now.
How many daughters does he have?
Two.
Three.
Three.
Oh, gotcha. All right.
What's the dog's name?
His dog's the one who just the bulldog that died?
Yeah.
Shit. What was
it? Starts
with a
B. Huh? Starts with a B.
Bianca.
Yeah.
Why don't you ask him some questions? I'm getting there. He questioned
me. And by the way, it was 45 years. 1975 to present.
Thank you.
All right. 45 years.
So he said 50 assets. So he's been going 45 years.
Yeah.
And it doesn't look like he's slowing down. He's loving life. He's doing what he loves. He's getting paid.
But look, that's my question to you guys. You could love.